Today we're with Elmer Dermer. We're in Sterling, Colorado. It's June the 29th, 2011, and we're going to hear about his life and times as a professional military man. He was in three wars, and he's living here in Sterling now and had his family here, I guess, and all that stuff, right?
Yes.
You can talk.
Yes. Yes,
yeah.
It is.
Yes. Okay, cut. Okay. Elmer, how you doing today?
Fine.
Okay, tell me your name. What's your name?
Elmer Dermer.
Elmer Dermer. And when were you born?
10-9-27.
10-9-27. Well, you beat me. Why, okay, well, we're going to hear about your life and times in the service. And so why don't you tell us when you joined the service, how old were you?
17.
17 years old. What happened to you?
Well, I didn't want to go in the Army.
Didn't want to go in the Army, okay.
So I joined the Navy.
Okay.
I don't know why, because I've never seen a body of water any bigger than the North Sterling Reservoir.
But, you were raised right here in Sterling.
Out at Atwood. I was
Atwood,
born in
yeah.
Atwood, and we was on the farm across the river between Atwood and Marino.
Okay.
Yes. Yes, and I went to school. Well, we lived 2 years in the 40s north of town here. I started high school at Logan County High.
Okay, hang on just a second. Cut. Excuse me, so I didn't mean to interrupt you, but we were getting a little noise there. So you were raised between Marino and Atwood. Go ahead and tell me. And
yes, sir. We was on the farm. There was farming. And I was getting up there pretty close to 18, and they were drafting them right out of senior year in high school then, because I guess it was pretty critical at the end of the war. But I didn't want to go to the Army infantry,
okay.
So I joined the Navy. And they called me to active duty in June of 1945. And I went to Great Lakes, Illinois for basic training. I think the Navy calls it boot camp.
Right.
So after 6 weeks of that, they put me in the Seabees. So I left Great Lakes and went to Camp Endicott in Providence, Rhode Island. And from there, they give me a 10-day leave. And after the 10 days, I went back to Providence. And they loaded us on a troop train and took us to California, Camp Parks. There, we got 6 weeks of Marine combat training. When I finished that, I went to Oahu in Honolulu, Hawaii, in a replacement depot. And I was there a couple of weeks, and they loaded us up on an aircraft carrier, USS Madagascar. I'll never forget it. And they took us to the Marshall Islands, and we was on Kwajalein.
Kwajalein?
Kwajalein Island was the main island there in the Marshall Islands. It was 3/4 mile long on the longest points. They had a runway on her, and 1/2 mile wide.
Okay.
And it was right at sea level. Every time high tide come in, there was about 4 inches of water. Went over the whole island. The tents were all built 3-4 feet above the ground. And there we, well, I was there at the end of the war, and they brought a bunch of Marines in from Iwo Jima and different places where they had battles, to mop up and clean up and collect all the armament and ammunition and all that kind of stuff. When we got that all cleaned up, we started to build a hospital. But in the meantime, they were working on Bikini and Eniwetok, building bunkers and observation booths for that first atomic bomb test they had there. We were in on that, and they had it on the Kwajalein. That's where they loaded the plane.
In Kwajalein, they loaded the planes for
They loaded the plane with the atomic bomb on that first test. They had a pit dug there with a hydraulic hoist in it to go up to the bottom of the airplane to load it up. But they didn't let us see none of that. We couldn't even get close to it. We wasn't supposed to know nothing.
You're
in fact, my mother said there was two men in black suits came later after I got out and asked if I ever talked about any of that stuff. And I know they were CIA men or whatever, you know, because we weren't supposed to say nothing. And we don't.
Top secret.
Yeah, I don't know what they wanted us to say. We didn't know nothing. They didn't tell us nothing.
You don't know anything, you can't talk about it.
Yeah, I still don't know nothing.
Right.
I know we were supposed to be 200 miles away from there when they dropped that first bomb, and we didn't quite make it. We was only 100 miles away, and we had one hell of a wave.
Did they?
Bounced that ship around, and it was a big APA troop ship, too.
Is that right?
Yeah. It was.
So you were on a troop ship when they dropped the bomb in Hiroshima?
Way back to Hawaii.
Oh, is that right?
The States. We
oh, you were
the
on their way back?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was in July of 46.
46.
July,
okay.
Yeah, when they done that. But we built all that stuff. We started building the hospital there and everything. We had a big hospital ship in the harbor there for bringing all kinds of casualties in from the islands. And we rounded up, the Marines rounded up all kinds of Japanese holdouts that they found on the islands. And brought them on. They had about 10,000 of them there.
Wow, is that right?
They were spooky too, but they did. I grew up real quick there.
I'll bet.
You know. And it,
so what did you run heavy equipment there and do that?
Yes, I was on a crane and some on a dozer some and a grader. We had asphalt plants there and we paved every road on the island. There was only 12 miles of road. So.
Is that, yeah.
Yeah, it was really a small island there. And then when I got out, I thought I was done. But when the Korean War broke out, I wasn't done. After they fired the second shot, I already had a 1A.
You did.
And they called me back in. I didn't finish the first enlistment. I enlisted for 2 years or the duration in 6 months. Well, I got out in 14 months.
Oh, and they called you back because you hadn't finished your enlistment.
I didn't finish my enlistment and I didn't want to go. So I joined the Air Force and I went up here to Lowry Field. And I was there about, I went in there in April. And in October, I was on shipment for Korea.
But were you in the Air Force then or the Navy?
In the Air Force.
In the Air Force. So you got out of the Navy?
Yeah.
And then you...
I was out for 5 years, putting her 5 years.
Oh, in the Navy?
Yeah, out of the Navy. I wasn't in the service. I went back on the farm.
Oh, you were back here on the farm
for
a while.
Yeah, I thought
And
I
then
was...
they called you back in?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah, because I was still in reserve, and I didn't even realize.
You and didn't know that, huh?
No. At that time, I didn't know much about the service and the paperwork, you know. And when you're on the farm, you don't hear much of that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
And so I wound up in Japan. And
But now you were in the Air Force.
I was in the Air Force then.
And were you doing heavy equipment in the Air Force?
Yes.
They had you doing that same thing?
Yes, bulldozers, cranes, backhoes, all kinds of graders. I got pretty damn good at it.
Yeah, I'll bet.
And from Japan, there was another young man when we was in the replacement depot at Camp Stoneman, California. He had just gotten married, but he was a cook. And he wanted to go to Korea so he could get back in the air. I said, it don't make me no difference. I know what them combat zones are like. You go right ahead. I'll go to Japan. And they put me in the occupation forces in Japan.
Okay.
I went down to Itami Air Base.
Hold it just a minute. Cut that. Ready. So, excuse me. We had the flag dropped off. But so where were you then? You went to Korea?
I went to, I stayed in Japan in
Japan.
The occupation forces.
Okay.
At that time. I went down to southern Honshin in Japan to an old Japanese fighter base called Itami. And I was in a combat support squadron there. They were flying missions out of there, and we had to redo all the taxiways and runways and get it in shape. And this base is located just about center between Kobe, Kyoto, and Osaka.
Okay.
And I was there for 2.5 years, and I was in charge of all heavy equipment, the runways, roads, cleaning.
What rank were you then about?
I was a corporal.
Corporal, okay.
Yeah. And I finally made sergeant there.
Okay.
And when I came back to the States, I was stationed at Camp Parks, California, which, by the way, I went through there during World War II in the Navy. It was a Navy base, and they abandoned it. And the Air Force took it over and had basic training there at Camp Parks. So
okay.
I went back there again, so it wasn't anything new to me. And then from there, my enlistment was up, and I decided to make it a career.
Okay.
Because by that time, I had 5-6 years in already, and I was getting up there in my mid-20s, and I didn't want to start farming again. So I just
you
stayed
thought that,
there.
Yeah, you thought that army was better than the farm, huh?
Well, I had a comfortable rank. I didn't have a lot of extra duties or anything, you know.
Yeah.
So I just stayed there. And when I cross-trained into helicopters were the coming thing then.
Yeah.
I went down to Gary Air Force Base down at below Austin, Texas. And went through a tech school there to be aircraft mechanic, helicopter.
Okay.
After 3 months, they put me out on the flight line. And I was a sergeant, and they made me a flight chief and flight engineer, put me on flying status there. And I flew from there, then we went down to Randolph Field. They moved the whole outfit down there. And I was down there until 58.
At Randolph.
At Randolph Field, yeah. Uh-huh. And when I, while I was there in 57, we made Air Force history. We had the longest ferry in flight in a helicopter that was ever made in the Air Force, the first one anyway. We took one H-19 from Randolph and flew it to Bridgeport, Connecticut, where they make them for overhaul and repair. Because every so many flying hours, they do that. And there was one there we picked up. It they had just worked over, but it belonged to Ramey Air Force Base in Puerto Rico. And so we flew it and started flying down there. And we crow-hopped all the way down from Bridgeport down to Tyndall Field, Florida. And from there, we went to Havana, Cuba. This was in December of 57. That revolution was just getting started.
Castro was stirring it up.
Yeah, they were acting up. They were stirring it up, yeah.
Yeah.
They greeted us at the airport there in a Jeep with twin 50 caliber machine guns on it and took us to the hotel, told us to stay in there, and they'd come get us in the morning and take us to our airplane, and that's what.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
You had an armed guard with you, huh?
Two of them.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we left there the next morning, and we was flying low. We wanted to see the country. We got toward Cienfuegos. That's where all the cane fields and everything were all on fire, and they shot at us.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so we went straight up in a chopper, and then we went forward. We went to Guantanamo Bay, stayed overnight, and from there we went to Port-au-Prince, Haiti. We had to stop and refuel. And by the way, we had to fuel it out of 50-gallon barrels. They didn't have it, the old rusty barrels, and I had siphon the gas through a chamois skin, not through the rubber hose.
So, yeah, keep the water out of it.
Yeah,
yeah,
the rust and everything.
Right.
And we went to Trujillo City in the Dominican Republic, and we refueled there. And from there, we went to San Juan, Puerto Rico.
Puerto Rico, yeah.
Yeah, and delivered that plane. It was their chopper for air sea rescue. And there we caught...
Now, was that a single blade?
Three blades.
Three blades, okay.
Yeah, it's pretty good size.
Yeah, big
plane.
Big.
Yeah, they were
big
really
good. Big helicopter.
Yeah, I'd done a lot of flying on them. Anyway, it was in the Air Force Times that was the longest ferrying flight of any chopper ever made. Up at,
is that right?
Time. Yeah.
Record flight.
Yeah.
Well, good for
sure
you.
Was.
And you were the crew chief.
I was the crew chief. It was me and Major Scott Johnson and Captain Lyle. He was a legal officer. Johnson was a pilot, but he was in at a headquarters there. He was also an instructor pilot on them helicopters.
Right.
Very, very nice officers they were. Anyway, when we went from Tyndall Field going across to Cuba, he called down in the cabin and he says, "Chief, if we happen to have engine failure and go down, what is the first thing that you do?" And I said, "Well, I jump out." And he said, "No, no, no." He said, "You throw the life raft out. I can't swim."
Said, "Never
yes,
mind,
sir."
Throw that life raft out.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't have to do that, though.
It was beautiful country.
Yeah.
And I hated to see Castro take over, but it evidently doesn't look like much now. There's some of the guys I knew that went down Florida and then places later said, "Boy, it's a mess." But from there, we transferred to State Air Force Base in Reno, Nevada.
Well, now, after you went down there, what'd they do, fly you back to base?
We had to get on a medical air back and hop back.
Medvac.
Right they brought us back to Brookfield, right outside of San Antonio.
San Antonio,
there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was on the 13th of December when we got back. So we had a lot of flying time.
Yeah.
And then I stayed there at Randolph until 58, and then they moved them. They wanted to get mountain flying and the pilots and things. We've done nothing but train pilots. We had a lot of Iranians and Thailand, and we had them from Vietnam. Pilot training, all kinds of Arab countries, Syria.
Now, where was that at? At Brooks?
At Randolph.
At Randolph, okay.
Brooks was our auxiliary. We had that field. I was responsible for caring for that field there later on when I went back in the 60s. I went, at Stead Air Force Base, I went back into my old career field in the engineering.
Okay.
And I no sooner got back in there than I was on a shipping to Rhein-Main, Germany. Well, before I could leave, they canceled that. Rhein-Main, Germany had sent me to RAF Elkenbury in England, London, England, right outside of London. What had happened, we had three bases in France, but they had nuclear weapons on them, and France run them out.
Oh, they want them out of there, huh?
Yeah, they had Chaumont, Évreux, and Lone, and that's why they sent me to England instead, because we had to get all them generators and all that equipment and bring it over to England and scatter it around on bases in England.
Okay.
So that's what I've done for a solid year there. So when I come back from there...
Well, now when they brought that equipment back, they fly it back or did they ship it back?
They flew most of it back and some they shipped.
Yeah.
Boxes and crates and things they shipped. But the heavy stuff like generators and stuff like that, it was on 124s. We relocated some of them in Germany, different places in Germany, and some in England. Now over there, there are generators everywhere because, like during World War II, the power was all knocked out. They relied strictly on generator power, and they had generators in England would fit in this room that size. They had one at the RAF Elkinbury. It had 13 cylinders on it, and it took a whole pickup load of batteries to crank the starting engine on.
Just to start, yeah, that right.
Yeah, it was really something.
Yeah.
But they had RB-66s, and they were all had atomic weapons. I know whenever I had to go around them with sweepers and things, why then I had to have white coveralls on and hood mask, and I had to wear a little button here, he called it a dosimeter.
Yeah, to see how much radiation.
See how much
you're
radiation
getting.
If there was any around there, and medics would read that every week, once a week.
Yeah, check it out.
Check it out, yeah. Or if you come out of a live zone, why you they check it in. But no, it's normal. Once a week, and you had to go in a hangar there, and you had to take a shower. Make sure you weren't check you all over, see if you.
Now those were atomic weapons that you were watching and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
They sure were. And that was in 59 and 60.
Yeah. Okay.
And when I come back from there, I went to back to Randolph.
Good. They just moved you all over.
Yeah. And then from Randolph, a year later, I got on a shipment to Sparavon, Alaska. It's a remote site out of about 190 miles straight north of Anchorage.
Okay.
There was nothing there, no road in, no road out. Right on top of Limestone Mountain Range, Mount Cairn. They had a radar site up there. It was part of that dew line.
Oh yeah, okay.
That
early warning
system.
Yeah.
And I was plowing snow with a D8 Cat, no cab. They wouldn't have cabs on there because they had one grader they brought in there, and they had a colored boy who was running it, because it had a cab on it. You know, it was warm in there, but it melted down inside, and then froze. The door was shut outside, and he went to shift gears coming down that steep slope. It was real steep. Put it down in the lower gear, and then it ran away from him. He couldn't get it in gear, and it went over the side. They found him next spring. But what had happened, the door froze shut, and he couldn't get out.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
So, and he froze to death there.
Oh.
So we had three D8 cats. There was three of us. We'd go up that mountain. We measured one drift off of one switchback. It was 84 feet deep.
Wow, is that so right? 84 feet deep drift.
Yeah.
Huh?
That aerial photo showed that D8 cat looked like a flea on the elephant's back.
I'll bet. Yeah. Yeah. So how'd they get that cat in there? Did somebody drive it in, or did they have to fly it in?
They flew everything in. There
flew
was
everything.
No roads.
Everything.
Everything. Toothpicks, pepper, toilet paper. They all flew in and out, mail and everything.
Yeah.
There was no roads in and no roads out.
Yeah.
That runway, it was crushed rock, but they wet it down and it was froze down. It was on a 33% grade like that. But it was 3,600 feet long, so we had to check the runway, and we had to get the snow, had to keep the snow off it, and ice, and they had several planes that crashed.
That's a pretty steep runway.
Well, going up, they had to stop, and then because it was icy, they'd slide.
Yeah.
And coming out, when they'd get a downhill run at it. But they didn't take no dozers or nothing out. They only brought it in, heavy equipment. I don't know. I imagine they probably took it out on sleds or something, or maybe it's still there. I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, when I come back there, I come back to Randolph again.
So were you, what, a sergeant then? Still a
sergeant? Yeah, I was a staff sergeant.
Running those crew of men and stuff, huh?
Yeah, that time there was, rank was hard to get. It was kind of peacetime. And then Vietnam started out again. It started up. And in 65, I didn't even know where Vietnam was. Well, all I knew by when I was over there was French Indochina.
Yeah.
But they changed the name on it. So yeah. I didn't recognize
French
the name
Indochina,
right.
Yeah, right.
So when I went over there, I went to Benoit down by Saigon. There was 25 of us, all non-coms. This was a special assignment. Nobody knew what it was because they had, for weeks they had me making up tool lists that I would need, you know, to work on equipment. And I didn't know what it was for. They didn't tell me. But I don't know what all different kinds of tools we used. But I found out we wound up in Benoit, 25 of us. And when we got over there, they had an airfield right up by Saigon called Tonsonute.
Okay.
And the VC just got done mortaring. Everything was on fire, smoke everywhere, and we circled for a half an hour. We was on a Continental, Golden Jet. And we went around, and boy, he come in straight down like that and landed. And that crewman in there, he says, "Now, when I pop that door, you get off. Get under that bunker that they had the PSP, pure steel planking, laying down there with dirt on top of it, and get under that." And I had an M16, and I had my duffel bag, and he opened that door, and I run down that gangway and run dead over General Westmoreland. Knocked him down.
Oh, who?
Yeah. And I said, "Sorry, sir." He told me to hit the ramp there. And he said, "That's okay, Sarge. Just get under there."
You plowed him down, huh?
Yeah, just knocked him down.
But you did what you were told.
That's the only time I ever had any contact with the general.
With the general?
American general. I run into a lot of Vietnamese generals.
Yeah.
They didn't know nothing. They didn't know as much as our PFCs.
Yeah.
They weren't no soldiers. But that Viet Cong was very dangerous.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You had to watch them. Well, they were guerrillas, you know. They were sneaky. We were there at pacification. We weren't there for war, for combat. But boy, they hit us on the 23rd of August with 50 rounds of mortar that night.
Wow.
The next day, that's what we kind of, they literally obliterated every plane on the ramp and on the runway and on the taxiways, everything in the living area. And 1st Infantry Division was supposed to be in our perimeter guard.
Yeah.
But this was in August and they didn't get there till September.
Huh.
But by the way, Dr. Kimball was in that.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, he done some surgery on me. I said, where was you, Doc, when the mortars come in?
Well, yeah, where were you?
He wasn't even there yet.
He hadn't gotten there, huh?
Yeah, I was there. We built revetments to store these airplanes in so they couldn't hit them with, you know. Because right beside our runway there at Benoit, there was a rubber plantation there. And there was a lot of people in there. It was sugarcane fields and there was a lot of bamboo groves. And it was right alongside the runway. And they used to get in there and shoot at us. Snipers. I had a lot of pings on my dozer there when I knocked down a lot of pillboxes and things and leveled off. So we widened that runway. Because we had, there's two U-2s there. And we had to protect them. They had a real wide wing spread on them. Sometimes when they come in, we'd have to go out there. We had a shack right on a flight line and hold them wings up so they didn't scrape on the pay on the runway.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It was all black. Boy, there was really something to see.
Yeah.
So I come back out of that there, and there was no time at all. They drafted me to go to Forbes, Kansas. There's an old army base there. It was 11 of us. I'm going to reactivate that. What are we going to do? What the Air Force, that prime beef team they sent in there, which, by the way, that stands for Base Engineering Emergency Forces. We built them revetments. But they were going to make a Red Horse Squadron, which I have a certificate on the wall over there. They looked for me for 30 years, because I was on the first squadron as an instructor at Forbes. 480 men. They brought them in three flights. We trained them there. And on the last flight, I had to go with them. I wound up at Cameron Bay.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I was there. We rebuilt. We built a whole base there at Cameron. I have a book on that. My daughter has it down in Houston, you know, on Red Horse, on our accomplishments. I was a project NCO. By that time, I was a tech sergeant, and I had crews all over the place. They had a lot of incidents there, too, but they had the Mekong River went through part of it there, and they had a pontoon bridge on it. At night, they'd pull it in. You couldn't get any in, but they could sit on the other side and with rifles and snipe. But we didn't do much work at night. We didn't have no lights on. And after I come back from there, I went back to Randolph again.
Well, how long were you over there at Cameron Bay?
Seven months,
mm-hmm. Wow.
I saw where John Kerry was talking about when he was running for president.
Yeah.
Because I pushed 2 feet of sand up on them boat pens where they put their swift boats in there.
Oh, yeah?
And went up that. Yeah, I knew exactly what he was talking about. Yeah. And when I was at Benoit, I was right on the river too, on the Mekong River there. I know what he was talking about. And we had a lot of incidents like that. They had a Green Beret camp there right outside of Benoit. And they took me over there on a Saturday. They had built a berm around for protection. They could lay on and fire off of.
Yeah.
Had PSP laying on there. And they had a hard rain, and it washed all the dirt down. And they told me to take a dozer over there and push that dirt back up. That was on Saturday. And come Monday morning, I was waiting for the tractor and trailer to come pick the dozer up. He said, "You don't need to go. The Viet Cong hit it yesterday and killed everybody in there."
Oh, boy.
And they just destroyed that camp.
Hmm.
And they had one other project there. They had a little schoolhouse sitting out in a rice paddies. They wanted me to cut a road up to it so they could run a Jeep or something up there. Yeah, it was all clear. This captain, Army captain, he was 10th Cav, he said, "I'll send a patrol out there Sunday evening at 6 o'clock and check it, make sure there ain't any landmines or booby traps or nothing along there, and it isn't occupied." Well, on Sunday evening, he sent the patrol out, a 30-man patrol. And that VC come out of that bamboo grove and killed every one of them.
Oh, my God.
So the next morning he was there and said, "No, we ain't going to fool with that." But that, see, it wasn't really war. We never knew.
Yeah.
It's pacification programs, they said. Well, on that Mekong, I went down there with a loader. I had to take a guard with me because I had an M16.
Yeah.
But I couldn't shoot it and run the equipment too.
Yeah.
So I always had a guard. And in one place, I cleared a fire path, what they call a fire path, killing path is what it was, so they could see that Viet Cong coming. There's nothing but bamboo. But the 173rd Airborne had a tent out there. And I had one buck sergeant on one side with an M60 machine gun and a corporal on the other side with an M16, and I had an M16, and we cut a fire guard through there.
Wow.
With a Dozer TD20 International, brand new. We had a lot of incidents like that, you know, yeah, in them combat zones.
That was a stinky deal.
Pardon?
That was a bad deal.
Yeah. Well, anytime you get around combat areas, you gotta expect that. But see, that was over there, remind me of that Viet Cong, a whole lot like these Arabs do now with these booby traps and all that stuff, you know.
Guerrilla stuff.
But what I can't understand in Arab nations over there on down them roads there, why they don't. I never saw a minesweeper on none of that equipment like they had in World War II. They'd find these things.
Yeah.
Before they hit.
Before they hit them, yeah.
Why they couldn't put something like that on there and do that. But I guess now in Afghanistan they are doing it. And two, when we was in the islands, these Marines would use these flamethrowers in these caves and things.
Do what?
Flamethrowers.
Oh, flamethrowers, yeah.
Yeah. Man, they did a lot of it.
Yeah.
I seen a lot of that, boy. They come out of there.
Yeah.
Why they don't use them in between Pakistan and Afghanistan, you know, them caves. I think I would.
Yeah.
Anyway, I wound up back at Randolph again.
Oh, I kept going back to Randolph.
Oh. Yeah, I was in there for 13 years.
Yeah.
And I knew when they sent me back there, I said, they got a special assignment again, and I'm going to get on it just sure as hell. So when they captured that Mayaguez, that spy ship in the China Sea there by next to Korea.
Okay.
In 68. I got her. I went to Korea. I had to go up to Suwon. It was about 60 miles south of Korea. It's an old fighter base. Had to open it up and revamp it and get it ready for F-84s and 86s they had over there. Yet I spent 13 years there.
Fixing that up, huh?
Yeah. When I come back, I come back to March Field, 69. And that's where I retired, the 21st Bomb Group. We had B-52s there, right outside of Riverside, California. Come back home there. So that just about ended my career. I retired there. I didn't want to go to Texas. My wife's from Texas. And I waited 6 months to get on civil service. I could have got on there all right. But I knew if I came back here, I knew what to do here.
<You did.
laughs> Yeah, I knew where I could work. And I kicked around and had some odd jobs to supplement my retirement.
Yeah.
And an opening came in here for the highway department on the interstate.
Oh, yeah?
So I took it. And I didn't want to be the boss, but I wound up the boss. I had two patrols up here I had to take care of, and they made me yard master over here to take care of all the transit machinery and stuff. Every time we paved or something, I had to take care of all that equipment and all those men and everything. And right before they run me to the eye doctor, I was having trouble. I run off the road all the time, and the foreman was following me. He said, "What's the matter with you?" I said, "Well, that snow coming over that mold board, I can't see." He said, "It ain't that bad." And I said, "Well, it is to me." He says, "You go to the eye doctor."
Yeah.
I went to Dr. LaForce. He's the only one I knew.
Yeah.
And he said I was legally blind.
He what?
I was legally blind.
You're legally blind, really?
Yeah. 250 over 20.
Yeah. Well, that's not so good.
No. And I'm still wet.
Yeah, so you got macular degeneration, huh?
Yeah.
Is that right? Yeah, that's tough.
Yeah, my mother had it too.
Yeah.
I got a brother and a sister that's got it too.
Got it too, huh?
Yeah, and yeah. Meniere's, inner ear problem. So That's why I'm in here.
So, so you came back. When, how old were you when you retired out of the Air Force?
41.
41 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So then, and then you went to work for the state.
Yeah.
And you you ran the state maintenance stuff.
Yeah, right up here on the interstate.
Yeah.
Their office is right next to the Justice Center there.
Yeah, I know where it is.
I worked
out
of that yard there by the golf course.
Out there next to
that. Yeah, I run that yard and two patrols. One patrol going this way and one going this way. So you had two patrols.
How long did you do that then?
Just about 18 years.
Did you?
Yeah.
So you put in three careers. You got two careers in the service and a career in the... Well, yeah, man, you just...
In a career farm,
But you never went back to the farm.
No, I never went back to the farm.
Never went back to the farm.
When I retired, there was a couple of guys that wanted some help, Al Crum from Iliff, and I wasn't doing anything. So I went down and run a track for him for a few days.
Yeah.
And Harry Luft out of here,
He
got sick, and he had first cutting hay down that bale. He had 1,500 bales laying in the field, so I went out and took his farmhand and stacked them up for him. That was the extent of my farming. Oh, I went over and helped Brian's dad for about a week.
Yeah.
When he cut his hand pretty bad, had something, surgery on his hand, and couldn't drive a tractor.
So
that was the extent of my farming.
Yeah, that's too bad. But just as well off, huh?
Well, in a
way. Now, somewhere along the line, you mentioned your daughter. You got married and you had some
I got married down at Randolph Field and I got two daughters.
Two daughters, uh-huh.
Yeah, Jennifer and Brenda. One of them's in Austin there and one of them's in Houston.
What do they do?
Well, the oldest one in Houston, she's married to a geologist that works for Exxon Oil now, but he had his own shop there, but he just wasn't getting enough business and he had this offer from Exxon and he's a good geologist. He's right up there on the governing staff now.
Really?
Yeah, in years time.
Well, that's a good place to be.
Yeah, he's $200,000 a year job.
Yeah.
And Brenda, she's right outside of her husband. He is the computer bookkeeper for the Borden Milk Company for the whole state of Texas.
Wow, is that right?
Yeah, Taylor Carback. His dad was Elmer Carback from San Antonio. New Braunfels really is where he lives. I know him. He's a heart specialist, surgeon. Real nice guy.
Yeah.
He's about my age, I guess, our age.
Yeah.
He's retired now.
Yeah.
I know when they got married, they had all kinds of wines and everything down there. And he said, come here. He's an old German, you know. And I knew his dad. His dad was a doctor down there.
Yeah, is that right?
He sort of delivered my youngest daughter. And he says, I got some private stock. He opened the cabinet there and he had a bottle of, I think it was Moselle. It was German wine.
Yeah.
Oh, it was that good.
Pretty good stuff, huh?
I said, you don't mind if I lean on this cabinet a while, do you? He just laughed.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
So did you get any medals, or you must have had a lot of awards and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
But you gave them all to your daughter, you said, or something.
Yeah, I give them to my grandsons.
Your grandsons, okay.
They all had to have something for show and tell in school.
Show and tell, okay.
They all got A's, every one of them. One of them still got my dog tags. One of them still got the last medal I got of meritorious service. Now, there's a picture there. I got my uniform on. I got medals on there, and I got all my records.
Okay, well, we'll take a picture of that.
There's one medal I got when I was in prime beef in Vietnam. I was the only one out of 25 that got a meritorious service, I think is what it's called.
Yeah.
But if you get the basic medal and if you win it again, you put an oak leaf cluster on.
Yeah.
Well, I got another one and I put an oak leaf cluster on it.
Wow.
I got one in Korea for my work in Korea. And then when I retired, I got one out of Marchfield for the work I'd done there. So I had
my gosh.
Three of them.
Oh, merit. Yeah,
they're not easy to get.
Yeah.
They're not combat medals, but they, two of them were out of combat zones.
Yeah. So, well, that stuff you're doing is tricky. Construction stuff in the fighting areas. Yeah, that's...
Well, see, like in Vietnam, we had elements from New Zealand, from Canada, from Australia, and I had to do with all of them. I had to, work with all of them.
Yeah.
It's not easy to do. Because they all got different ideas.
Yeah, they always want to do it a different way.
Well, that's the way they know it. That's the way they done it, I used to tell them, well, there sits the cat. Do it your way.
Yeah, you take it.
Yeah. Oh, we don't know how to run that thing. I said, well, if you don't know how to run it, why are you telling me how?
Yeah.
But yeah, that's, you have to talk to military that way.
Yes.
Plain and to the point.
Yeah.
You can't bargain around or hee-haw around. Either you are or you aren't.
Yeah.
And if you're not careful, they'll get you killed.
Yeah.
I had a corporal with me. He says, he'd never been overseas before. He says, I'm going to follow you. I know you're coming back. I says, just don't get in my way or you won't come back.
Yeah, don't get in my way. That's a good way of putting it, yeah.
Yeah, because there at Benoit, they had a narrow track railroad and somebody had dumped a bunch of dirt on it, and I think the reason they dumped it on there is so they couldn't ship supplies in Viet Cong, They told me to go wipe that dirt off that track. They wanted to restore that track so they could use that warehouse there. Well, while we was there looking around, me and this corporal, a Vietnamese truck pulled up and they had five Viet Cong on there. They had them blindfolded, all dressed in black pajamas. And they had their hands tied behind them with barbed wire. This Corporal Finley, he's from New Braunfels. He says, what are they going to do? I said, just hang on a minute and you'll find out. They unloaded them, they lined them up on that concrete wall. Here come the firing squad, shot them.
Really?
Yeah, they executed them. And that Corporal, he turned white, and he turned red. He turned white again, he started bombing.
Yeah.
They scared him so bad.
Yeah.
He says, how'd you know what they was going to do? I said, well, what else would they be bringing them in here for? I said, hell, that's enemy. I said, you can ride home and say you saw Viet Cong.
Yeah.
But I had a picture. I was parked along the taxiway. There was a plane coming by. It had washed the rain. They dumped me a bunch of dirt. I was on a grader, and I was blading that in, and here come a correspondent climbed up on the side there. And we had orders, we weren't supposed to talk to them. We weren't supposed to tell them nothing. Well, hell, we didn't know nothing, And he was standing up on the side of that grader just babbling there, and when that plane went by, I said, you better get off, I gotta go. And he says, just a minute, I want to talk to you. I said, if you don't get off, I'm gonna cover you up. He stood there, and I just let the clutch out, and he fell off, and he went rolling down the ditch here, and I just kept going. I don't know whatever happened to him. But he went by the checkpoint. I don't know how the hell he got by there. He wasn't supposed to be out there.
Yeah.
And they had a pagoda right up above us there at Benoit. And they were sniping down there. They filled these big 5,000-gallon gasoline bladders. They take to these Green Beret camps and helicopter pads and things. And they told me to set a 50-gallon barrel, and then put another one on top and fill it with dirt so they couldn't shoot down all that pagoda in them bladders. And that's what we was doing. And a C-130 pulled up there, and they dropped that tail. And they had a bladder there. They had it on pallets, and they were just loaded in, and there was people standing by the fence out there. Oh, they might hear across the road, maybe a little further, not much further. And there was a woman there and some little kids there. And she pulled that old pant leg up, pulled a rifle out, and sighted it down in on that ladder. She was going to shoot that ladder. And there was a Marine guard there on that ladder, and he used it and shot her, dropped her right there. The next day, here come the Stars and Stripes. America's servicemen shooting women and children. Well, if it hadn't have, she'd have blew the whole damn runway up.
Yeah.
That corporal there again, he got pale.
I bet.
And we took 50 rounds of mortar shells one night. And I'll never forget that one either. It's about 10:30 at night. The Viet Cong, they always harassed that night. They'd fly a little airplane over and they'd drop hand grenades out and things like that. But anyway, the first one hit and I knew it, well, I could hear it coming. And I said, let's get the bunker, I told his corporal. And he says, just as soon as I get my pants on, I went. And that mortar dropped and it hit me. And the gravel hit me in the back. But I didn't know it was gravel then. I thought it was shrapnel. And I kept feeling to see if I was bleeding or anything.
Yeah.
I couldn't feel it. Well, the next morning I looked, I was all black and blue down there in my fatigue jacket. Had little holes in it all over and had black spots on it, which was powder marks.
Yeah.
But I told that corporal, I said, next time that alert sounds, I said, if you ain't got your pants on, don't worry about it.
Don't worry.
Get the hell out.
Yeah.
The barracks next to us, they hit dead center and they killed 38 security guards in it. But we did have another attack. And his corporal, he passed me. Well, now, he went right through the door. He didn't even open it. Screen door. He went right through it, boy. I said, well, they ain't going to get you. You're learning.
That's right.
But I don't know, it had some rough spots, but all in all, I think I'd do it again.
Think so, huh? Well, we're proud of guys like you.
You know, it was just something that I took to, you know, and I stayed a staff sergeant about 5 or 6 years.
Yeah.
And I said, well, if I'm going to be a lifer, I might as well make something. And it didn't take me long. I retired a master sergeant. And I made master about 4 years before I retired.
Good for you.
So I could have made it long before that, but I was single. I was having a good time.
Doing all right.
I really didn't have time to, you know, dedicate myself.
Take care of the details.
I was down there at Randolph Field, and there's a lot of country western dance halls around there and ice houses. You know, I was having a hell of a time. Because I wasn't shy or anything. In between shipments, I might as well enjoy it.
I think you did good.
Yeah, I never had any trouble. I got one medal on there. I've got 4 loops on it. Those are all good conduct medals.
Yeah, is that right?
Yeah.
We'll take a look at that. Okay.
Yeah, I think you can see them on that one picture. You kind of got all my ribbons on there. And my records have everything I was ever awarded.
Now this is when he was in London, and he shows his Master Sergeant Stripes, Air Force, looking really sharp here. Now this is his discharge papers for the Air Force. This is when he was in the Navy.
Yeah.
So he was in the Navy and the Air Force for how many years total?
20
years total. Yeah. Got that pretty good here. Just a minute.
Yeah. The only time 20 years I was ever in the SAC Strategic Air Command, I was
Charlie's in